already left. I ran a very hot bath and just sat there. The tears dripping down my cheeks. I just sat there, my fringe all cockeye and the tears dripping down my cheeks into the hot water. It was as though the world had come to a sad, despairing, tearful end. But of course, it hadn't. Oh, one does things. One goes to see friends, one does one's work, one fusses with this and that. Kind friends tell you time is the only doctor, and it's true, but he's a slow worker, that time, and no anaesthetist at all. Suddenly you've lost everything. The hours are long, and only 1,000 hours will help to heal. Would he might come again, and I upon his breast again might lie. Would I had not in foolish wrath driven him ever from my path. Would the sun the day's course over might that same day's lost dawn recover. As vain as this, vain prayers are all vain prayers that would past days recall. Never shall sun now sunk away rise up again on yesterday. Never shall love, untimely slain, rise from the grave and live again. And so what is left? Bitter, resentful, lonely, with this sadness, deficiency feeling. I tend to think a great many people carry this feeling around with them all their lives. A lot of people pretend out of bravery, I suppose, that they're quite ordinary, rather dull chaps. But really, they don't feel at all at home in the world. They don't make friends easily. Oh, they laugh a lot and joke, and their chums think they're quite all right and jolly nice, too. But sometimes they get so tired. The brave pretense breaks down, and then they are lost. I wrote a poem about this once. I got the idea from a newspaper report about a man drowning.
Nobody heard him, the dead man, but still he lay moaning. I was much further out than you thought, and not waving, but drowning. Poor chap. He always loved larking, and now he's dead. It must have been too cold for him. His heart gave way, they said. Oh, no, no, no. It was too cold always. Still the dead one lay moaning. I was much too far out all my life, and not waving, but drowning.
I do love them, but really, so tiring. By the time I've got myself ready, I'm totally exhausted, and I arrive looking like the sheeted dead. Miss Stevie Smith, they call, and in I walk, the sheeted dead.
Peggy?
Yes, it's me. I'm back. And I never know what to do with my hands. I keep thinking, what shall I do with my hands? Plus the ghastly business of having to find the bathroom. Whenever I'm excited, I have to dash straight for the bathroom. Nervous enteritis, they call it. Straight for the bathroom. It's so embarrassing, especially with strangers.
Peggy, is that you?
Yes, it's me. The Lion Aunt has become a dreadful worrier. She worries about everything these days. She doesn't go out much either. Well, hardly at all. She thinks the house stood so much during the war that now it mustn't be left. I know how she feels. It's only stood an awful lot. The Blitz, the Doodlebugs, ooh, V2s. The Home Guard used to practice in the park, I remember, and we had a searchlight unit by the allotments. Hey-ho. What a time it was, though, the war, I mean, my word, yes. There were some people called Rackstraw, I remember.
I've been calling and calling.
Oh, I thought you were just saying hello.
Look at this. Another letter from those income tax devils. You hid it in the fruit bowl.
I don't suppose it's very important.
Well, it looks important. On Her Majesty's service.
What does it say?
I don't know. I haven't opened it.
Why not?
I was waiting for you.
Oh, I...
What are you drinking?
Brandy. Do you want some?
No. No, I'll have a cup of tea.
Oh, well, I'll get it.
No. You stay where you are. I'll get it. How was the party?
Oh, very jolly.
Good.
She's getting old, becoming an old lady. I must be careful not to give the wrong impression about being middle class, I mean. Suburbs people are extremely class conscious, and I don't approve of that, oh no. I was once in this terribly refined tea shop in Evesham when this poor, dirty old man came shuffling in. Well, he'd obviously made a mistake. He didn't realize how refined this tea shop was. The tea shop lady was very snooty. This English woman is so refined. She has no bosom and no behind. She took the old man very gingerly by the coat sleeve and led him to the door. She wasn't going to have him there. Oh, no, that wouldn't do at all. Poor old man went shuffling out, drips falling from his damp nose. And as he went, he said, "It's a fucking stock-up tea shop." I sometimes think it's a fucking stuck-up world. And it's the middle classes, I'm afraid, who are the worst offenders. Oh, yes, they are the ones who fight to the last ditch for the public schools and the privilege idea because they think they are so nearly about to grasp it for themselves, so nearly about to send their kids to Eton. Never a thought for the kids, mind you. Never a thought for the kiddos' welfare. Parents who barely can afford it should not send their children to public schools. Ill will reward it. Are you all right? What happened?
I broke a plate.
So I see. Come on, give it to me, I'll do it.